Yes, that's right. This game indulges in a goddamn circular plot. We end the game where we fucking started it.
She's gonna tear this whole damn planet apart!
Oh, weapons change over time. I haven't used this much. I might as well bust it out. Is my... Yeah. That. Oh no, I already have that. Okay. Cool.
We need to get the terraformer running. It's our only chance.
The closest entrance is through the visitor center.
Then let's start there. Show me the way.
Okay, yeah, I think they're just gonna be endless. Oh, it's one of you. Well, then here. I can't really. Oh, what the fuck? Yeah, you know what? Where is it? Oh my god, the little pests. Oh, I'm gonna disintegrate you too. Don't you worry. What is it, all just you big bastards? Oh, nearly wiped myself with my own nanites. You know, I'd like to elaborate more on some important points with regards to the plot of this game. But it seems difficult, because this ending has sufficient bombast to prove distracting. I got rushed by the behemoth, didn't I? Probably what happened. Because I disintegrated, so yeah, I was probably rushed by the fucking behemoth. Alright, good, we didn't get sent back too far. Are you not dead? Or are you a different one? I don't care. Be dead. You have the right to be dead. Oh my god. Man, my ear. Oh boy. Where's the spawners? Ah! Again, we are here to fix this place, right? So why am I destroying everything?
Main entrance is blocked! There's no way we're going through that! We need another way in!
Building schematics show an auxiliary entrance several floors above us.
On it.
Which way, Sam?
Through the ventilation shaft.
This better not lead to the garbage dump.
And you made another Star Wars reference in your already ripe, you know, ripe, rife, whatever, with cliche game.
This is a disaster.
The secondary units will need to come online before the core can be repaired.
Damn bugs aren't gonna make this easy.
Oh, that's not good. That's really not good. Well, I managed to narrowly avoid death there. Two for one shot, alright. You guys have a spawner or something? Where are you guys coming from? So here's the thing. Sure.
The environmental control unit must be engaged.
Thanks, Sam. So here's the thing. Sure. The game sort of subverts the cliche of killing the queen and then you kill the hive or all of that, you know, stuff. However, this subversion comes with an alternative means of destroying the aliens, and it even avoids the unfortunate trope of the aliens having some ludicrous weakness to something that they, you know, shouldn't even be weak to. You know, like in Signs, where they try to invade a planet. Or even just scout a planet whose surface is covered 70% by water and they're vulnerable to water. Or War of the Worlds, where a species capable of interplanetary travel and vaporizing people just by whatever is unable to acknowledge or deal with the fact that there's just the common cold. So, because that's the thing, mankind imposed our atmosphere on the existing Mars atmosphere, and
support
these creatures.
System online, purging environmental toxins.
It's working. Let's get the rest.
And these creatures prefer the Martian atmosphere as it was before we altered it, and so we're going to be using the terraformer to change the atmosphere back to. Like, the way we had it before Hale blew it up, and Hale blowing up was probably to facilitate his access to these insidious creatures in all likelihood. He had access to Ultor's files. He'd know exactly what they were vulnerable to. And it also explains why Capek would have buried them underground, because they wouldn't have been naturally vulnerable to the Martian atmosphere at the time, because Mars hadn't been terraformed. It all clicks. It all makes sense. Except for one massive, glaring detail. Why in the fuck, when Hale first destroyed the atmosphere terraformer, did Darius not fix the fucking thing right then and there? Because we're here, we have no more equipment or anything than we did before, except for the enhanced processing module on the Nanoforge. But if you're groping for that as the one reason why he couldn't do it before, what, was that module just non-existent? Was it unavailable? And besides which, are you telling me that they just couldn't get it so that he could have fixed this years ago and they wouldn't have been living underground? I mean, maybe the storms were so bad around the atmosphere processor that it was just unreachable, because don't forget, Darius hitched a ride on the Queen herself, took him straight here. But here's the problem. You know, regardless the explanation, the game doesn't give you one. Almost like there isn't one. Almost like they pulled this out of a hat at the last minute, or they just didn't think that, well, hang on a minute, going to fix it, like, years later in the context of the plot, why couldn't they just fix it then and there? Nobody fucking considered that.
Engage the environmental systems.
Oh, goddammit. You know, weirdly, I didn't die this much on my first time through, and I hit fewer upgrades. Granted, I also had fewer distractions. I wasn't LPing it. You gotta kind of split your brain between doing two different things. Oh, god, we gotta do that. All of that all over again.
Purging environmental toxins.
It's working. Let's get the rest. Gotta get this blast shield open.
System overload. Rebooted.
Oh, you gotta be kidding me.
Systems.
Crisis averted. Are they just going to spawn in endlessly?
That's two down. Where's the next one, Sam?
I guess they were.
Engage
Seems like the railgun with like a headshot or something is just an instant kill regardless of the amount of health it deals. Well, I guess the more things change, the more they really do stay the same. Now, where's the other one? Why do I feel like we got a big and ugly down there? Oh, because we do. Oh, a really big and ugly. Take it around you somehow. Yes, there are plausible reasons for why, like, Darius couldn't just do this shit back when it first happened, like, fix it immediately after it was broken. However, none of them are mentioned in the story. The writers made no mention of why that didn't work.
All secondary units are functional.
Where's the core?
So instead, fans are left trying to explain it with fucking, like, whatever they can pull out of their ass. A fucking Arkham Asylum door. Jesus. Does it need to be that fucking complicated? It has cover panels, bars, and a rotating, like, central lock. Uh-huh. I defended myself, game. Now what? Yeah? Oh, for God's sakes.
Terraformer can come online.
Now we've got to get this shit off him first.
You know, I appreciate at least one subversion in this game from, like, just being a total made-by-committee cliche fest. You know, because that's the thing, we don't kill the creatures necessarily by killing the queen. Again, we change the atmosphere, and that's what kills the creatures. But the thing is, this last section does drag on for a bit. You missed.
The central core units must be repaired before the terraformer can function.
Yeah, maybe we should thin the herd first. It's actually running low.
Got them all repaired.
Systems online. Initializing. Error. Core software failure.
Oh, come on!
Rebooting.
The terraformer core must be defended while the system resets. The bugs are targeting the core.
Gotta hold them off while the core reboots!
Core functionality at 25%.
For God's sakes!
The central core units must be repaired before the terraformer can function.
How about getting your own shit back in your face? Get off my... So I'd recommend using the range repair thing instead of walking around with your frickin' thing out trying to... Are their attacks homing all of a sudden? You're fucking kidding me, right? They never displayed a homing capability before. Now all of a sudden their attacks zoom right for the power cores. On.
Core functionality at 75%.
Hold off a little longer.
Shield is also helpful here. As in addition to defending you, it can help protect some of the cores. The bugs don't know which ones to target. Hey, Mars looks, well, more hospitable.
Your family name?
We're down to it. Wrecked half of Mars in the process.
Yeah, but you got the job done.
We all did, Frank.
Sorry about Carl.
Thanks.
Burst of radiation is about to penetrate the atmosphere.
Easy there, genius. It's the sun.
My sensors are overloaded.
Mine too.
That's a weird line. Especially for what is technically your last line in the game, that your idiot AI companion is confused by the fact that sunlight is coming through, and then delivers a robotic equivalent of an emotional reaction to that, like, what the fuck? Okay, closing thoughts, you know, distinct and separate from what I'm going to be going over in my comparison of Guerrilla and this game, which I only feel I need to do, because so many people sing a thousand praises for Guerrilla, yet shit all over this game. I prefer this to Guerrilla, to tell you the truth. I played through Guerrilla once, and I was just, for the LP, and I was done with it. Now, I had played halfway through it previously, never finished the game, because it's very easy to just be like, God, how much more scrap am I going to have to get? How much more fucking busy work am I going to have to do? Whereas this is my second time playing it in the space of about a week. Not including the time I had that false start. And you know what? I still enjoyed it. Because it has weapons with actual bite that work. The upgrade system isn't a goddamn grind fest. The corridor-driven affair actually makes better use of the geomod technology than the open world did. And the characters have character. Archetypical, cliched as all fuck character, but character better than the planks of wood, which make up more than half of the named characters in fucking Guerrilla. Oh my god. And yes, the story is fucked. The story is completely fucked. The Red Faction as a standing army. The fact that you're gonna have huge important plot things missing if you haven't seen Red Faction Origins. The story is completely fucked. But Guerrilla's story only held together for the first two-thirds of it, the first two acts. In the third act, it gets rushed and it kind of falls apart. So story is the one place where Guerrilla could really claim dominion, shall we say, over Red Faction Armageddon. But, like I said, it's not supported by good characters. And aesthetics. I like the look of Guerrilla more than this, because again, the appearance of things in this are very cliched, and also very distant from what we see in Guerrilla. Now, granted, it's been 100 years in-universe. I mean, saying that things should look design similar is a bit like saying that something in the aughts would look similar to something in the 1900s. It doesn't make sense. But the thing is, from a creative standpoint, you want some points of visual anchor. And I mean, those exist. The towers look like the EDF towers from the previous game and so forth. So you've got a little bit of visual connection, but it's not so much an issue of how unlike Red Faction it looks, it's more just how weird it, like I said, you got an assault rifle that you reload with a cylinder that plugs in the top, and it's got three barrels that, like, reciprocate on a spring. What the fuck is it? You got a shotgun that you gotta break it open backwards to replace the magazine to. the weapons design is just all over the fucking place. But yes, I enjoyed Armageddon more than Guerrilla. And I'm sorry if I sound inconsistent in saying that. Not on the grounds that I'm inconsistent in my opinion. I enjoy Armageddon more than Guerrilla. My problem is I sometimes get the names confused. That sometimes happens, so I'll say that I'm enjoying Guerrilla more because I mistake Guerrilla for Armageddon. They have multi-syllable, you know, Red Faction colon title names. My brain gets a little like, and then you know. Yeah, these credits run surprisingly long. I mean, anyway, so yeah. Now, at this moment of recording, I haven't played Path to War. I read up on it. It's different perspectives of the raid on the atmosphere processor, so not quite prequel. I mean, that whole section of the campaign was kind of a preamble to what came after it, so a little bit of prequel in there. So I'll probably, like... Well, here's the thing, because I could slip that in immediately after the thing in the processor, or put it before... I don't know. I won't be able to assess where would be the best place to attach that to the rest of this LP until after I play it. Because if it doesn't end... if it ends before the moment where, you know, everything goes wrong, it'd be better to play it before and then have that in the campaign be, like, the spoiler. Otherwise, it'd be better for me to actually air it after this. So, I'm speaking from the past, not knowing where that's going to go. So this might be the last video in this series you see, or there might be more to come. But in case it is the last, I want to have my nuanced bases covered. So, thank you all so much for watching. This is the final game in this series, so I'll be moving on to other things after this. Red Faction has gotten a lot of attention from a lot of people, because I think it has a lot of nostalgia for a lot of people. It has a lot of nostalgia for me, too. I think I probably played Red Faction before I ever played Half-Life. So, yes, the description for all of the videos released past a certain date have a link to the playlist. They have a link to, like, a game series playlist as well. The reason those aren't on end cards is because it would be more prohibitive for me to put it on end cards. I'm stressed for time as it is. Besides, you scroll down on a lot of things in life, I think you can go down to the description. You know, because that's the common complaint, like, oh man, I gotta go into the description. Yes, you have to go into the description. It's not gonna just pop up on a magic end card just because I'm literally greasing the road for you so you can just slide your way into it. But before I completely alienate my viewing audience, thank you all so much for watching. Check out other things that I've done. I hope you've enjoyed this nostalgia trip. And even if this is the end of this game, do expect a follow-up without anything visually interesting where I illustrate why I think Armageddon is better than Guerrilla. Because I don't think it's a hot take. I think that to some extent people are actually blinded a bit by nostalgia and the time in which the game's released. But I'm not going to get into that here. I hope my viewership is staying happy and healthy out there. I'd like to thank all of my subscribers, both long-timers and newcomers alike. And as always, dear viewers, fare thee well.